Our second scripture lesson this morning is taken in two different places. Let's start with John 10, verse 26 through 28. But you do not believe, because you are not among my sheep. My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they will follow me. I will give them eternal life, and they will never perish. No one will snatch them out of my hand. And from the book of Revelation, chapter 7, verse 17. For the Lamb in the midst of the throne will be the shepherd, and he will guide them to springs of living water. And God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. This is the last of my series this month. And it's probably one of the most important lessons in itself. Hard lesson that sometimes we either choose not to understand, don't want to understand, or don't even want to hear. During the 3 years that Jesus traveled and taught, he used parables to help people understand the important truths about God. And who remembers what a parable is? It's just all it is. It's a short story. A short story that has a meaning. A story that seems very simple, but really isn't. Toward the end of Jesus' 3 year ministry, as it got closer and closer to the time when he would be crucified, he started telling stories. And one of those stories was about a man who went away for a while and then came back. That particular parable is called the Parable of the Ten Talents. It says that we learned that a man who returned from a long trip to see what his servant had done with the gifts that they had been given before he left. Two servants were very thankful with their gifts and were rewarded by their master. But the third servant didn't even try to use his gift. Because of this, it was taken away from him completely. In today's scripture lesson, this actually is a parable. The sheep and the goats. In this parable, we're going to learn about a shepherd who returns after an absence to divide his flock into two groups. The sheep on one side and the goats on the other. As we will see, one of these groups is rewarded by the shepherd. The other group is sent away from the shepherd and punished. Jesus used this very important parable to argue, to let people know that getting into heaven is not as easy sometimes as we make it out to be. It's not just doing good works or being a good person, but it's about the only way that it is truly right, truly a way to be made right with God. And that's the blood of Jesus. We need to make atonement for our sin once and for all. And we need to believe in him. Ephesians states, for it is by my grace you have been saved, through faith, and not this from yourselves. It is the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. So he kind of used this parable not to imply that works bring salvation, but to show there are many, that there are many of us there in this world today that merely pretend to know God, that merely pretend to love God. We know how to say the right things. We know how to do the right rituals. But we have never truly lived a changed life. We have never truly lived the life that he shows us how to live. And that's what he's trying to get across in this parable. We're going to go back over a little bit of this. The Son of Man will come in all his glory. All the angels will come with him. Then he will sit on the throne in the glory of heaven. All the nations will be gathered in front of him. He will separate the people into two groups. He will be like a shepherd who who separates the sheep from the goats. He will put the sheep on his right and the goats on his left. Many of the people that Jesus would have preached to in his day would have recognized and been well familiar with sheep and tending flocks. They would have known that during the day the sheep and the goats tend to mingle together in the same pasture, share the same valley. They just roam where they please, where the shepherd leads them, but at night their needs are different. And when they came in at night, the shepherds would separate the sheep from the goats. So I want to talk a little bit about the difference between the two. They might look really similar and they might make the same noises, but the personalities and behaviors are very different. Now look at this little guy. You know, he looks pretty cute, doesn't he? He looks pretty innocent. But anyone who has ever spent any time with goats knows that they are trouble. Goats are very independent animals. If the shepherd decided to go on vacation for a week and left the goats to survive on their own, they could probably do it. That's how independent they are. But let's look at this next goat. Okay. Goats have huge appetites. And goats will eat anything and everything to satisfy their hunger. The shepherd has to be really careful because another goat will often eat every last bit of food that has been put out for her babies, leaving them to go hungry. She just will use her head and bump them out of the way so that she can have their dinner. Another thing about goats is that they're motivated by their own desires. For example, and this is what's common, goats tend to like the taste of hair for some reason or another. And they will, a shepherd, if he doesn't watch it, the goats will sneak up behind and try and chew on his hair. And the shepherd doesn't like this, of course, and he punishes the goat when he does it. But the goat can't stop thinking about how good that hair tastes. So a little bit later, when the shepherd lies down to take a nap, and he's not watching so close, the goat is right there, chewing on the sleeping shepherd's hair and hopefully avoiding any punishment. Goats love doing what they want more than they love pleasing the shepherd. But now let's take a look at the sheep again. You know, from a distance, it looks like sheep have it all together. They just hang out in their pasture and graze on the grass all day long and play with other sheep and just frolic in the sunshine. But the truth is sheep require so much help to stay alive. I told you the story about how a sheep, if it falls on its back, it can't figure out how to get up, and it will eventually die if the shepherd doesn't show it how to turn back over. Also, sheep have a real strong tendency to panic. I remember we used to do this as kids back when there were some herds of goats and sheep between here and Marquette. We used to drive that every Sunday to see my dad's mom. And when dad would catch a herd of sheep out of the pasture, as he drove by, he would honk. And when you honk at a herd of sheep, they'll run literally in circles for hours. They'll run into fences, they'll run into together. They just won't settle down. They just go into a total panic. But sheep also feel very calm when the shepherd is around. They'll follow him anywhere because they've learned to trust him. They know when it rains, the shepherd will find shelter for them. And they know when they're hungry, the shepherd will take them to green pastures filled with tall grass and give them food to fill their bellies. They know that the shepherd is the one who cares for all their needs. We've been talking about all through the Bible. All through the Bible, God calls us his sheep. Psalm 95:7 says, he is our God. We are the sheep belonging to his flock. We are the people he takes good care of. Listen to his voice. voice today. And I read this scripture a couple weeks ago in Mark that says, when Jesus came ashore, he saw a large crowd. He felt deep concern for them. They were like sheep without a shepherd. So he began teaching them many things. So think what we've learned about sheep this last month. We've learned that they're totally helpless without their shepherd to guide them and to care for them. And we know that we are like those sheep and that God is our shepherd. We belong completely to God, our shepherd. He cares for us and would never leave us completely alone. And because of that, we can trust in him to give us everything that we need. So let's go back to the parable again and see what happens next. Remember, the shepherd has divided the sheep and the goats, the sheep on the right, the goats on the left. And you'll notice that from this point on in the parable, and this is very important, Jesus does not talk about the shepherd anymore. He talks about King. Jesus is our good shepherd, but he is also the King above all kings. And he is coming back to rule over the earth. And this, the first thing that this parable tells us, that when he does come back, he is going to decide who is a sheep and who is a goat. It says, then the king will speak to those on his right and will say, my father has blessed you. Come and take what is yours. It is a kingdom prepared for you since the world was created. I was hungry and you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger and you invited me in. I needed clothes, and you gave them to me. I was sick, and you took care of me. I was in prison, and you came to visit me. Sounds like the sheep did a pretty good job. But this is where sometimes people didn't understand Jesus' words. Jesus said they fed him, that they gave him drink, that they made friends with him, and that they came to see him. So, what does it mean to us today? How can we possibly become one of the sheep when we've never, ever even met Jesus? We haven't had a chance to give him a turkey sandwich. We haven't had a chance to minister him, to do anything to him, and the people in that day were confused also. Because here's what they said. They asked Jesus, when were you hungry? When did we feed you? And when did we take you in? And when did we give you something to drink? But we know from the parables and the rest of the Bible that Jesus always had a good answer when people were confused. He knew that his parables were often kind of mysterious and hard to understand. And that's exactly what he wanted them to be. Because he wanted people to think hard about what he was saying. But Jesus never, never, ever left people with any doubt about what he meant. That's why the king in this story gives a very clear answer to the sheep's question, to our question today. The king will reply, what I'm about to tell you is true. Anything that you did for the least important of these brothers of mine, you did for me. The king, Jesus, told the sheep that because they had loved and cared for the people around them, they had loved and cared for him. And the sheep are the ones who get invited into the kingdom of God. And if we keep reading into this, it says the sheep have not earned their place in the kingdom through the good things they did. The scripture talks to us about that. There are not enough good deeds in the world to change the fact that we have been separated from God by sin. Scripture again says everyone has sinned. No one measures up to God's glory. But if we keep reading, especially down in Romans, it says the free gift of God's grace makes all of us right with Him. Christ Jesus paid the price. God gave Him as a sacrifice to pay for our sins. So He forgives the sins of those who have faith in His blood. And I don't know about you, but that's pretty exciting stuff. Because God loves us so much and doesn't want sin to keep us from having a relationship with Him. So we sent Jesus. And Jesus died on that cross. He died so that our sins could be forgiven. And He didn't just die for some of us. He died for all of us. You know, if we would sit down this afternoon and take a couple sheets of paper, or give some sheets of paper to a friend of yours and let him follow you around and just have him start writing down every sin that you did during the day. And you just keep it up, day and night, day after day. It wouldn't take too long before you couldn't even carry the papers around with you, could you? And that's me, that's you, that's us all. But because of the scripture, because of what Jesus did for us, it's done. And it's that easy. It's done. So, none of the things that Jesus talked about, the kind of love that Jesus talked about, none of it's easy. But it's simple. When you see someone that doesn't have enough to eat, why don't you just sit down, pull out your lunch, and have a joke with them? If you see somebody by the side of the road and they're thirsty, go down to the next door, give them a bottle of water, bring it back. That's all he requires of you. Just a lot of it's just simple time. If your mom's sick, if your grandma's sick, and you haven't seen them in a while, pick up the phone and call them. Go see a friend you haven't seen in a while. Because you've been too busy. That's what makes a sheep. So, I know this is getting a little bit long today, but this is an important message. If we go back to the parable now, what do you think Jesus is telling the goats here? He will say to those on his left, he says plain and simple, you are cursed. Go away from me into a fire that burns forever. It has been prepared for the devil and his angels. These is sometimes a part of the message we don't want to hear. There are consequences to what we do. There are consequences to where we behave like sheep or behave like goats. And those people, those goats, they have the same question. They ask Jesus the same thing. But Lord, how can I do that? When did I see you? And how could I have helped you? When could I have given you a drink? And Jesus tells them the same answer. The king says, what you have done for the people around you, you have done for me. That's it. That's it. I promise you. The attitude of the goats is this. If we had known it was you, we would just have helped you. Why didn't you just let us know? See, the goats have an excuse. The sheep have looked for excuses. Some of us will help other people. Some of us will go out of our way, but only if they get the praise and the recognition that they need. It isn't about praise and recognition this morning. It's about doing what is right. And in this parable, let me make it plain and simple one last time. In this parable, Jesus tells us that the kingdom belongs only to those who